Hi, welcome to the video solution for past paper. This is Edexcel IEL Physics Unit 4, January 2020. So let's start. Question number one. A neutron can decay to produce a proton. Which of the following equations correctly shows neutron decay? So this is all about a particle physics question. A neutron is decaying into proton. So when you see some validity of any nuclear equation, so there are something that you know, some conservation laws you keep in your mind. Number one is most common is charge conservation, charge before and after, and then lepton number conservation and baryon number. These are most common situations or the conservation laws that we need to take care for this. So we have an you know, neutron decaying into proton, so we cannot have option A, because you see we have total charge zero on the left hand side, and on right hand side we have plus two, like this is proton, so plus one and plus one, so we have total charge plus two, we have zero charge here, so we cannot have option A. Similarly, we cannot have option B as well. The reason, again, same, charge is not conserved. For C and D, we have charge conserved, like charge is zero. For neutron, charge is zero, zero plus one, minus one. So total charge is zero before and after. For D, we have charge conserved, zero plus one for proton, minus one for electron. So on the basis of charge conservation, we cannot decide. Now let's move on. Let's check lepton number. So lepton number for part C, lepton number before is zero, because there's no lepton before interaction or before decaying. So lepton number is zero. And after we have lepton number, this is electrons, so lepton number one, and antineutrino, lepton number minus one. So plus one, minus one. So lepton number conserved. That means it should be option C, because if you see D, the lepton number before is zero, and after lepton number, the for proton it is zero, this is minus one, and this is anti this is electron neutrino, so minus this is electron, lepton number plus one, electron neutrino, so plus one, so lepton number is plus two, so lepton numbers are not conserved in given option D, so only option is C. So charge is conserved, lepton numbers are also conserved. That's why option is C. Question number two. At distance D from a point charge of magnitude Q and potential is V. The potential is V. Which of the following is a potential at a distance 4D from a point charge of magnitude 2Q? So you know that if you need to find potential at point 4D with the charge 2Q, because for Q we have potential V. So we know that the potential in terms of distance is V is equal to ED. So this is the relation between potential and the distance for charge Q. This is for Q, suppose. Now let's for 2Q at a distance 4D. So first we figure out how much electric field is there for that distance for this charge. So electrical field E, general formula for E is K Q by D square. This is again for charge Q. But now, if you find electric field for charge 2Q, so you will have to say E dash, the new field, E dash is equal to K 2Q divided by D square, and distance is 4D, that means 16 D square. So 2 and 8, that means new electric field E is 1/8 of the previous one. So now you can substitute here. So V is equal to 1/8 of E into D, and D is, you know, 4 times, which is D. So 4 ones are 4 and 2. So you can say new potential V dash is one half of the previous one. So your option is B. A ball of mass m traveling with velocity v strikes a wall at right angle. It bounces off the wall in the opposite direction at the same speed. Which of the following is the impulse on the wall? Impulse. You know, impulse is change in momentum. Change in momentum. So we cannot figure out directly considering impulse on the wall, but we can find impulse on the ball. Impulse on the ball. Why am I saying this? The reason is because we don't have, you know, it is really difficult to figure out only considering wall. But we are given velocities of the ball before striking and after striking. So we can figure out impulse on the ball, and impulse on the wall will be opposite to that impulse on the ball. So impulse on the ball, IB would be change in momentum. So MV minus MU. And you know that suppose if you take a rightward direction, now this is a ball and a ball is going rightward with the speed V. And it hits the ball wall and then bounce off with the same speed, but in terms of velocity, as it is vector, the velocity will be minus v. So initial velocity is v, final velocity is minus v. So initial momentum will be mv, final momentum will be minus mv. So you can say impulse on the ball will be minus mv, final momentum minus initial momentum mv. That means minus 2mv. This is impulse on the ball, and you know that impulse on the wall would be minus of negative of impulse on the ball. That means it is positive 2mv, not negative ones. So your option should be B. The diagram shows equipotential lines about a point charge. This is a point charge, 6 volt, 4 volt, voltage is decreasing, and these are positive values. Which of the following diagrams shows a possible combination of electric field lines and polarity of charge to produce this pattern? Clearly, if you see the diagram, we cannot have option C immediately gone, option B immediately gone, because this is showing that positive charge but fields are coming in, which is wrong. This is negative charge, fields are going out. It is absolutely wrong. So we need to choose either A or D. And of course, you see the values of the potentials are decreasing and they are positive values. So of course, this must be a positive charge. So your option is A. Question number 5, the diagram shows a potential difference applied across two conducting parallel plates. So these are two plates, 10 volt and plus 10 volt and 0. In between we have X, 20 centimeter. Point X is midway between the plate. Which of the following is the electric field strength at the point X? So 50, 50, 100 and 100. Clearly, because this is parallel plate, so electric field strength is E is equal to V by D. It is uniform everywhere between the plate. So V is the potential difference, which is 10. Divided by D. D is 20 centimeter, so 0.2. So when you solve this, so it will be 50 volt meter inverse. So we have 50 here, we have 50 here, that means C and D gone immediately. The difference is the direction upward and downward. Clearly, this is positive potential, zero meaning low potential. So field lines will be downward. So option is B. Question number 6, a gamma photon of energy 18 million electron volt or 18 mega electron volt produces a particle and its antiparticle. Which of the following will give maximum possible mass of particle in kilogram? So this a single photon of 18 million electron volt producing a particle and its antiparticle. That means half of energy will produce particle and rest of the half energy will produce antiparticle. That means we need to consider only 9 million electron volt with the particle, for the particle, creation of the particle. And this is the energy that is going to produce only one particle. And we need to convert this 9 million electron volt into kg. So the idea is you multiply energy, the given energy, into joule, convert it into joule first by multiplying 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19, and then divide this E by square of the speed of light, 3 into 10 to the power 8. That's how you can convert given energy into mass in kilogram. So 9 into 10 to the power 6 because of million electron volt, and electron volt into joule, you multiplied it by 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19. You need to divide it by a square of the speed of light. So 3 into 10 to the power 8 square, or C square. Option is D. Question number 7. A current carrying wire is placed between two magnetic poles. As shown, the magnetic flux density in the region between the pole is 0.070 tesla. North and south, 1.5 ampere current. This is I, this is B, magnetic field. This is the length of the conductor in diagonal, and width of the magnet is 5 centimeter. Which of the following gives the magnitude of the force on the wire in Newton and its direction? So a current carrying wire placed in a magnetic field experiences a force F is equal to BIL. We have B, which is 0.07, we have current 1.5, but only confusion is what the length of the conductor. And remember, if we are using this formula, that means we need to take conductor, the length of the conductor, which is perpendicular to B. So if you see, if you find the length of that conductor, which is perpendicular to the B, so you can, you know, use this thing. That means this will be the component of the length. Component of the length of the conductor perpendicular to the field, and this length, clearly from the diagram, this length will be equal to the width of the magnet, 5 centimeter. So this L is 5 centimeter. You can convert it into meter if you need. So your formula should be F is equal to B is 0.070 times current is 1.5 times length, and length is 5 centimeter, which is should be 0.05. So now we have two options, either C, because 0.05, or A. We cannot have B and D, so immediately gone. So A and C. So only another thing that we need to talk about, the direction. So if you use your left hand, Fleming left hand rule, and you set your first finger in the direction of the magnetic field, which is downward, and then the second finger of your left hand should be in the direction of the current, which is, so this is direction of B, this is direction of the current, and then you will see your thumb. If you adjust your left hand, right hand rule, so you will see your thumb will be out of the screen or out of the page, outward, or out of the page, or if you see the screen, out of the screen. So as this is the paper, so out of the page. So your option should be C. point charges of plus q and minus q are placed at x and y. These are the two points, plus q and minus q, respectively. When another charge is placed at z here, the resultant force on the charge at x is zero. Distance xy equals to distance yz. These distances are equal. Okay, which of the following is the charge placed at z? What charge should be here? Either it is q by 4, quarter of q, or half of the q. Clearly, you can immediately ignore A and B, because we cannot have a smaller charge at z to cancel the field of these two charges. So this charge should be stronger than these. And another thing that you need to understand in these types of question, remember, if you have two points A and B where you put two charges, q1 and minus q1, suppose. So two equal charges but opposite in nature, one positive and negative. That means there will be no point with the there will be no point at which you can see that force is zero. Okay, so everywhere all around this configuration we have some force exist all around this configuration. So if two equal and opposite charges are there, there will be no point at which we can say that there will be zero force. Okay, so now if you ignore that point Z, then due to Q and minus Q, we cannot have a zero force anywhere. But suppose I have two points A and B, and in these two points we have a equal amount of same charges, like plus Q and plus Q. Same nature, both positive charge, equal amount. That means we have a point in between these two charges, exactly in between here. We have electric field zero, because both field will be cancelled at that point. So at that point, electric field will be zero, so force will be zero. So if we have a two equal charges, then we have a field zero in between. What if I say, if you double any one of the charge, if you double, like if you make this plus q as plus 2q, you double this charge, that means the force of the charge at B will be stronger or double. So you would have electric field zero at point A. So at point A, you would have electric field zero. So for double of the charge, then you have a field zero. But in this other situation, we have some negative charge as well. So this charge has to cancel field of this positive and field of this negative charge. So we cannot have option 2q, because 2q is the simplest case when we have a two same charges at some distance. So of course option is D. It should be 4q. I gave this explanation just to intuitive approach, just use your intuition that what should be the amount of charge, because if I give a complete derivation, it is too long for this type of question, because it takes a long time to drive net electric field E1, E2 and then E3, and then figure out what should be the answer. So the best option is use your intuition and these two concepts and figure out what should be the answer. So option is D. Question number 9. The diagram shows the momenta P and Q of two bodies about to collide. So these are the two particles P and Q, and they are about to collide here. So these are initial momenta. When the bodies collide, they merge and move on as a single body. Which of the following diagram shows resultant momentum? clearly because bodies are joining and, you know, merging and joining and moving as a single body. So we have just one momentum after the collision. That means if you need to find the final or the resultant momentum, you just visualize what how do you find the resultant of these two vectors. So the easiest way is you just visualize what happened when you join head of the P with the tail of the Q. So you can visualize Q is displaced and Q bring here, something like this. This is Q, head to tail rule. So your momentum will be something like this. So that will be a resultant, like this. So of course, if you see the diagram, which one is matching? A is gone immediately, B is gone because it does not match. And C and D, but you see here for D, the direction of the resultant should be toward the last vector in that direction, not toward the first or initial vector. So you cannot have option D. So the resultant vector is C, resultant momentum is C. Ten, in an electron diffraction tube, electrons are released by passing a current through a metal filament. What is the name of the process that releases the electron? A typical question from metal filament, or you say emission of electron from metal filament after passing a high amount of current. That means the metal filament is heated and then it releases electrons. So it's all about thermionic emission. So option should be D. Question number 11. A section from the periodic table is shown. Element symbol. These are some element symbol. Okay. Atomic numbers are there. Technetium TC is produced when a deuterium ion collide with a nucleus of one of the other elements shown in the table. In this process, a number of neutrons are also released. Deuterium is an isotope of hydrogen, one proton and one neutron. Complete the nuclear equation to determine the element and the number of neutrons released. So it's all about balancing the nuclear equation. So everything should be balanced, charge and the mass number and the coefficient as well. So you see here, this is the hydrogen, which is not a normal hydrogen, but it is isotope deuterium, one proton and one neutron. So the symbol for deuterium should be 1. 2. And then if this is 1, 2, so you can see the mass number 96 and 2, which is 98. So this should be, you know, the right hand side should be 98 as a mass number. This is neutron and the mass number of one neutron can be just 1. But 95 plus 1 is 96. We have 2 left. That means we must have 3 neutron here. So 3 neutron means the mass number of neutron, 3 neutron will be 3. So 3 plus 95 is 98. So mass numbers are balanced. And this is neutron. So charge of the neutron is 0. And then you can balance the charge again. So this is 0. And so total charge would be 43 plus 0, 43. So here charge is 1. That means it should be 42. And if you see the 42, so 42 is coming at molybdenum, so MO. The following passage is taken from an article about the history of particle physics. Mystery particle. By 1932, scientists knew of the existence of the subatomic particles, the electron, the proton and the neutron. These were believed to be the fundamental particles. In 1936, scientists were using tracks of cosmic rays to identify a predicted particle known as meson. Instead, another particle was discovered, the muon. This was so surprising that Nobel Prize winning physicists, Esider Rebbe, said, "Who ordered that?" Described how the underlying particles fit into the standard model. So underlying particles means we need to describe how all these particles, electron, neutron and proton, muon and mesons, can, you know, be fit into the standard model. Remember, a standard model is all about a model that describe types of particle existed, sorry, not the, yeah, the type of particle exist in the universe. So remember, there are 12 fundamental particles, 12 fundamental particles. Fundamental particles categorized into leptons and quarks. So there are 6 leptons and 6 quarks, and these are 12 fundamental particles. And further, because quarks does not exist in free state, so in free state the existed particles are categorized into hadrons and leptons, because these are the particles that exist in free state. Leptons are fundamental, and that involves electrons, muons and tau and other neutrinos, while hadrons are the particles that further divided into, you know, hadrons are particles that made of quarks. So quarks combine and they make hadrons, and these hadrons further classified into baryon and mesons. Baryons are the hadrons composed of 3 quarks, Q1, Q2, Q3. I'm just giving symbol. These are not actual symbol of quarks. So you can just say they are made of 3 quarks. And mesons are made of 2 quarks. One is quark and the other one is anti-quark. 2 quarks. Quark and anti-quark. Moreover, proton and neutrons are left. So you say that proton and neutrons are baryon, that means they are made of 3 quarks. That's how we fit all these particles into our standard model. So you need to describe all these things in your statement, and that's how you can write all these things. Question number 13. The photograph shows a jumping toy. The head is pushed down on the base comprising a spring. When released, the spring expands and the toy jumps into the air. A student investigated the toy. The student placed the toy on the balance to measure the force required to compress the spring. The force was 14 Newton when the spring was fully compressed by 1.7 centimeter. When the toy was launched, it jumped to a height of 1.5 meter. Show that maximum energy stored in the compressed spring was about 0.1 joule. So it's all about Hooke's law and stored energy. So we know that the energy stored E is equal to half of F into delta X, where F is the force required to compress or stretch. Delta X is the extension or deformation. In this case, half F is 14 Newton required force to compress divided by delta X, and delta X is the compression in this case. So compression is 1.7 centimeter. So compression is 1.7 centimeter. So you say that this is centimeter, so must convert into meter. So 0.017. So energy will be 0.119 joule, and you say E is equal to 0.112 joule, which is approximately 0.1 joule. Initially, the spring was fully compressed. As the toy was released, the head accelerated upward on its own until the spring was uncompressed. The head then pulled the base upward and they moved together at the same speed. Okay, so this is the condition, fully compressed. It is moving up, accelerating. When it just fully uncompressed, then it's take the base with it and both move together. Okay, the student used the elastic potential energy stored in the spring to determine the maximum speed, and the student used gravitational potential energy gained by the whole toy to determine its initial upward speed. Determine whether the toy obeys the laws of conservation of momentum using the values of speed calculated in this way: mass of the head, mass of the whole toy, and maximum height jump. So we need to find velocity of the head using stored energy, and then we need to find velocity of the whole toy using gravitational potential energy. So we have two velocities. Let's see, we work out for velocity of the head. So for head you can say half m VH squared is equal to 0.12, which is elastic stored energy we found in previous part. And you can rearrange for this for velocity because mass of the head is given, which is 6.4 gram. So once you solve this, so VH would be equal to 0.12 times 2, which is this 2 will be coming there, and m is dividing. So dividing by 0.0, it is, yeah, divided by 1000, so 0.0064 square root. So velocity would be equal to 6.1 meter second inverse. This is velocity of the head. Now let's just talk about velocity of the toy. For whole toy, so half m vt squared is equal to mgh, where m is the mass of the toy, which is cancelled. So vt squared is equal to 2gh. G is 9.81, h is the height gain, which is 1.5. Once you substitute all the value, take the square root. So velocity of the toy would be equal to twice of 9.81. I'm not writing, you will have to write. So the answer will be equal to 2 times of 0.0072 times 1.5 meter. It will be 5.42 meter per second. This is the velocity of the toy. Now we need to figure out whether these calculated values obeys law of conservation of momentum. So momentum of the head is mass into velocity, so 0.0064 times velocity of the head, 6.1, which is 0.039 newton second, and velocity of momentum of the toy, t, is mass of the total mass of the toy is 0.0072 times velocity, which is 5.42, and then the answer will be equal to 0.039, and that means momentum of the head before jumping and momentum of the toy after jumping are same. So yes, it does. So yes, law of conservation of momentum holds. Determine whether the kinetic energy was conserved. So kinetic energy, we need to find kinetic energy of the head and kinetic energy of the toy. So since the kinetic energy EK of head is equal to 0.12 joule, as In part A, you can give the reference. We have already found the elastic stored energy is equal to the kinetic energy. So this is the energy stored. And now find the kinetic energy of the toy, which is T, and it will be equal to half mv squared. So half m is 0.0072 times v squared, 5.42 whole squared. So kinetic energy is 0.105 or approximately 0.11 joule. So clearly kinetic energy of the head is not equal to kinetic energy of the toy. So of course it does not, so energy does not conserve. No, it is not conserved. A track for go-kart is being built in a park. The design criteria state that the track must have a semicircular ends with a straight track in between as shown. So semicircular straight track. The track must allow the go-kart to travel safely at a speed of 35 km per hour or 9.72 meters per second on the bend. So on this bend, the maximum speed can be 9.72 meters per second. Mass of the go-kart and the driver is 185. Diameter of AB of semicircular end is 30. So diameter is 30. So radius will be 15. So just keep this number in your mind. 185 is the mass, 30 and 9.72. For one design, the track is horizontal. As the go-kart go around the semicircular end of the track, centripetal force is provided by friction between the track and the tires. This is shown in the free body diagram below. So this is the friction, that means this is, you know, a circular track here. So of course centripetal force should be inward towards the center. So this is the centripetal force, or you can say centripetal force provided by the friction. Show that this design meets the design criteria. So the straightforward option is, using the given information, we figure out whether this frictional force is sufficient to give the, you know, velocity that is required for safe motion. So let's do this. We know that we are giving frictional force, that means this is centripetal force. So we can use formula for centripetal force. So Fc is equal to m v square over r, and we need to figure out this v. And if this v matches with the design criteria, so we can say yes, it is. Okay, so Fc is you just rearrange it for v. So v would be equal to Fc r divided by m whole. So v is equal to 1180 and radius is 15, because diameter was 30 and mass is the 185 square root. So v would be equal to 9.78 meter second inverse. So indeed the velocity is close to the design criteria. So of course it meets the design criteria. A second design uses a track that is banked at semicircular ends. The track is banked at an angle theta to the horizontal. Okay, this is the road banked with the angle theta, weight and normal reaction. At a particular speed v, the go-kart can follow the track without any frictional force perpendicular to its motion. The diagram shows the forces on the go-kart as it is moving away. Show that tangent theta is equal to this. Okay, this statement is saying that if we have some particular velocity and some angle, we don't need frictional force to this car to provide centripetal force. The reason is, in some specific condition, the component of the normal contact force provides the centripetal force. Remember, if you recall the inclined plane problem that you did in your AS, generally what do? We resolve weight into its component. Even if you are doing M1, so you know for inclined plane, this is our habit. If we have some particle and we have some weight, so we resolve weight into its component, and we say that we have a W cos theta here, and we have W sine theta. But it is recommended that when you have some inclined plane involving with centripetal force, so it is easy. We can use this concept, but it will take long way to prove our required. So we need to do some additional step. So instead of resolving weight, what do? We resolve contact force into its component. That's what I'm going to do. So you know that if you resolve the contact force into components, so this is the contact force R here, and one component of this force would be something like this, acting upward like this, and the next component will be this, and direction of component is this. So clearly, if you use your geometry, if this angle is theta, this angle is theta, so this will be 90, and this is 90 minus theta. Use your geometry, this is 90 minus theta, remember. This is 90 minus theta. Because you can imagine, this is theta, this is 90 minus theta. And if this is 90 minus theta, this is total 90. So this will be 90 minus theta. That means this angle is theta in this triangle. That's the difference. This is theta. So now we resolve R into its component. This is adjacent component and this is opposite component. So meaning this component would be equal to R cos of theta. And this blue component would be R sine theta. And if you see the diagram, R sine theta is acting rightward. And this is, you know, center of the circular track. So R sine theta is in fact gives this car as a centripetal force. And this R cos theta is balancing, you know, it is acting upward. So R cos theta is balancing the weight. So that's how you can compare, you can see that, or you can write, since R sin theta is your centripetal force, so you can write R sin theta is equal to mv square upon R, centripetal force, and R cos theta is equal to mg. And then you can divide these two because we need tangent here. So if we have two equations in terms of sine and cos, so we divide these two equations to make it tangent. So we divide these two equations, so sine upon cos becomes tangent and R gets cancelled. So you say that the left hand side, if you divide, R gets cancelled, sine theta upon cos theta, it will be tangent theta is equal to mv square over R divided by mg. So mg will come here and mm gets cancelled again. So tangent theta is equal to V square upon Rg. V square upon Rg. And we need the diameter, not the radius. So R is d by 2. So this R you replace d by 2. So V square is Z divided by d by 2 into g. And this 2 goes up. So tangent theta would be equal to 2V square upon dg. That's your required equation. So don't worry, there's a you will be looking at there's too much working, but again, you can skip a step whatever you want if you are understanding. Part 2, calculate the angle theta using stated design criteria for this track. So if you need to find theta, that means you need to use your value V and D. G is 9.81. So you can say theta is equal to tangent inverse of 2V square, 2 times of V. V is 9.72 whole squared divided by dg. D is 30 centimeter. D is 30. Let me just recall, it is, what was that? It is 30 meter. Yeah. And then 9.81. It should be 30 meter, 9.81. That's how. And then theta, when you solve, theta would be equal to 32.70. So theta is equal to 33 degree. A banked track will cost more to build. Suggest whether there are any significant advantages that would justify the cost. There are many, but most common, we just generally say that due to banking, we have a safe ride. We do, there is a very less chance for skidding the car, and bank provide large centripetal force so that the car or whatever object is remains on the track because of the centripetal force. So that's how you can write. In 1908, Rutherford, Geiger and Marsden investigated the interaction of alpha particles with matter. In one set of experiments, they directed alpha particles towards a thin gold foil. State why the alpha source and gold foil were contained in a vacuum. Of course, because alpha particles is, bombarding or directing towards the gold foil, so there must not be any other particle. If air is there, then there will be a chance of collision. So in order to avoid collision with the air particles or air molecules, they put these in vacuum. At the time, one model for the structure of atoms was the plum pudding model proposed by J.J. Thomson. In this model, a positive charge and mass were spread evenly throughout the atom. Negatively charged electrons were distributed within the atom. Discuss the extent to which the result of alpha particle scattering experiments justified replacing the plum pudding model with a nuclear model of the atom. So it's all about Rutherford experiment that you need to explain, that when alpha particle is were directed or bombarded toward the gold foil, so what was observed and what was the conclusion. So when alpha particles were bombarded, so we observed that most of the alpha particle pass straight through the gold foil, and there were very few which were deflected with a small angle. So these two observations were indicating that, because most of the particles pass through straight and some pass deflected very small angle, that means most of the region of the atom is empty space. That's why they pass through straight. While in plum pudding model, the atom is not empty. It is mass is evenly spread out. So if it is evenly spread out, so we could have some other observation, not this one. We won't have a small deflection here. This is one point. And another thing is we have a deflection, very few deflection with the angle greater than 90 degree. So this is angle greater than 90 degree angle, greater than 90 degree. So, and this deflection is showing because we have very few. That means for this kind of deflection, we need some place with a very, very high mass and very, very high charge concentration, because high mass or a large mass and high charge concentration, very strong charge concentration, will provide sufficient force to push alpha particle backward. So that's what, you know, it is only explained with the help of nuclear model, not with the plum pudding model. So you can include all these points in the answer of this question. So that's how you can write. Thank you very much. I hope you understand. Have a nice time.